Welcome back to Super Week, where Sin have just won 0 Direwolves, but we have Game 2 coming up just in a second. But before we jump into it, guys, we have got a competition we're running right now. We need you to collect the 3 keywords. Once you have them all, I cannot stress this enough, do not tweet along the way, guys. Please, tweet all 3 on Wednesday night to @lol_Oceania. You'll win a cool prize. That's the competition. They're going to be a word hidden around the broadcast. Last night's words is left. Can't say it again, unfortunately. This night's word will be coming up somewhere shortly in the broadcast. But let's get back into things. Want to talk about Chippies, because this guy's an absolute legend in the top lane. Was able, like, you don't Fido Chippies, Alice. This guy is the king of Fido. And it looked like that's all they wanted to do when he came back bigger and stronger.
Exactly. And managed to pick up that fantastic double kill towards the top side of the map. And Chippies was a nullifying factor in that game. He was able to get there where he needed to be. And then laid down the shields, had the glitter lances for the slows, really controlled Direwolves in their sort of skirmishing style that they're known for. And he just sort of cancelled it out. And it See you later.
It looked like someone they wanted to attack coming into this game as well. We saw the Twist of Fate try to port down to the bottom lane and get an early gank on him, which was successful, but never became anything of it.
Yeah, and there was actually a couple of key moments in that game where you were like, Chippies is about to become irrelevant. He's 30 CS behind now. But Juve's actually did a pretty good job of not last hitting. This is something I'm very critical of junglers on. If you're going in for a gank, make sure you don't take it away from your top laner who's already starved. And Chippies got some key kills and was able to scale up and be relevant in this game.
Yeah, it's exactly right. And it's what I was speaking about before, that double kill, one glitter lance. Oh my God, that's the feeling that you want. You know, you see that glitter lance goes a couple of different directions, both of them net you a kill. Oh, baby. Feels very good, and he got it, and then everything was fine. Stunning.
The thing that I want to point out is I actually don't think I've ever seen Atlas play Lulu, so I don't know if he's actually...
Hey, I've recently picked her up.
Oh, you picked her up?
Yeah, all right, that's cool. Why, very recently. Very, very
he's
recently.
More of a Rai Meister man. He does like his Diana. That's the pick I want to go to next. Very contested right now for Rai. You know, he's got a great Yasuo, Diana, similar vein of a champion. Do you get rid of them both? What's the go there?
Bennett, get rid of it. He's shown time and time again that he can play this champion and play it really well. Don't risk it. Just get it off the Zerift.
No. Don't worry about it. Like, the thing is, Fantix now has the counter pick.
What?
Let him pick it. Let him pick it, and then Fantix pick something that isn't Twisted Fate, something that's not going to get hard countered by the champion straight up, and then just dumpster him. Please prove me right, Fantix, because I called you the best player in the OPL that last game. Was not good enough. And I don't need you to step up, please.
Like a disappointed father. No, that's Carmen's line. So that's where we're kind of looking in the top, in the mid lane. It is a 1v1 matchup. Rhymeister versus Fantix is very excited. But maybe a bottom lane we didn't give enough credit to is that of Sin Gaming. Rogue and Kha'Zix came up huge against Raze and Kuden. Something that maybe Ejim and Radiant tried to do yesterday. Executed very, very well from Sin this time around.
I love that you bring up yesterday as well. Because this is the really exciting part. Is the fact that Raze and Kuden played the exact same lane of the Braum and Alistar into the Kalista Alistar. The Braum and Ezreal
yep.
into Kalista Alistar.
We were with you. Yep.
I got there in the end. But the point is, they managed to win that. Just wear it on the other foot. Sin come back and just show that, yeah, that lane's going to win, boys. Like, you figured it out yesterday, and it's still true today. And they did a fantastic job. Of course, Kha'Zix even got dived in the top lane. We've mentioned this so many times before, is that Kha'Zix isn't the one to necessarily make the moves, but when the action comes to him, he's able to deliver, was able to go 1-for-1 under turret.
And that is actually the example I was going to use to demonstrate how smart Sin played this game. When Fantix rotated back towards mid lane for first blood, he burnt his flash in a situation where he was 100% dead. He actually flashed further away from his base than he did towards his base, gave up a kill, really set the tempo because all of a sudden you can't make aggressive plays on Twisted Fate. Kha'Zix gets dove in the top lane. Trades 1-for-1 and doesn't burn a summoner spell because he knew he was already dead, got the most out of the situation. Really got to respect the veteran AD carry out of Sin.
And this was a bottom lane coming for Direwolves as well, which I thought was going to be the insurance policy, so to speak, for the Direwolves. I thought no matter what, they're going to be the ones that are going to be solid. They're going to be ones that perform really well. But it is Sin that came out on top. That's right, the veteran of Kha'Zix in the bottom lane with Rogue, his support. They play phenomenally and just helped Sin out so
now,
much.
Now, gentlemen, the 8-Ball is a very gracious mystical being. It is going to give you a chance to renege on your earlier prediction. You've already got it wrong. How far do you want to go down this path, Atlas? Are you going to say that Sin will now win this series?
I want to ask to hear what the 8-Ball has to say first.
So he's already said 2-0, Sin. I'm not asking him again.
All right, well, Sin are going to take this game.
Sin's going to take the game? Yep. What do you think, Fish? You're on equal footing, so if the 8-Ball wins this one, I just want to let him know, at least in my book, he's ahead of you. So...
I'm going to say Direwolves still win 2-1.
Well, there you go, guys. We've got a split desk all of a sudden. The 8-ball causing turmoil everywhere. But we are ready to get into game number 2. So here's Pastry Tart to take us there.
Thank you very much. Thank you, 8-Ball, for your bold prediction so far earlier. But you were at least right for the first game, as Sin looked very strong taking out Direwolves there. Direwolves have to be reeling a bit, but we do see it. We saw it already yesterday. They lose games, they're relatively one-sided. They're always good at coming back in a series.
It goes without saying, right? Direwolves, they've lost so many game ones now in the OPL that game two, you just feel like it's an entirely new side. It's almost like a part of their strategy. Lose game one, come back stronger for it. I wouldn't be surprised if that's what we see now, but most importantly, it all starts in drafting.
It does, and it felt like Sin had a very clear plan. You know, the Wombo got banned out. They probably expected the likes of the Yasuo, the Malphite bans, the Diana or something. It seems like they've been practicing the overall game from Sin that you mentioned, Frostgo, and it's much sharper. So I think Sin, if they have another good plan, they play like they did around the map, they should be looking good for a potential upset 2-0, but it is going to start here in champs, like Sin swapping over to the blue side. Dialov's over on the red, and a Corki first ban there.
You also have to understand that, you know, having Twisted Fate taking the Ignite into the mid lane, I'm not going to call it disrespect. I'm going to call it confidence. But I don't think that we'll see the same thing this time around. Confidence.
Yeah. I think it could have went like Exhaust. I find it like a pseudo-offensive spell. It reduces resistances, reduces their damage. It's an all-in champion. They didn't really have an Exhaust to combat Rhymeister either. And what I want to actually touch on when I say drafting is an issue is Direwolves had no answer to the split push firstly, when you can assume that Rhymeister is going to play Diana. It goes without saying, he plays Diana now, right? It's just his thing. They didn't have an answer. They had a Twisted Fate mid lane.
Should be noted also that from the red side, Direwolves lose out on a lot of their target ban ability. So the Dust was talking about how just take the Diana completely off the board, which I actually expect. But that means that you're going to have to trade it for something like Gangplank, Malphite, or Kog'Maw.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, that could be a problem. Yasuo was the first ban. Direwolves stick to the plan from game one. Elise also banned by Sin. So a very similar looking ban structure this time around. And there's Lulu, so they're going to change it up a little bit. Chippy's Lulu, getting some respect there.
It's not a bad ban by any means. I just think Lulu is strong, and Chippy's 100 CS down, still relevant.
Yep.
That is the big
That's
thing.
Lulu.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, Gangplank banned away there. Not too surprised on that one.
Yeah, it's because the Lulu was banned. And again, we were talking about kind of like if they followed the trend, Malphite, Kog'Maw, Gangplank are all kind of the big champions. At least Malphite was banned last game. So by taking away the Lulu, I agree with it. It is a strong champion, but it does open up the ability to ban Gangplank from blue side because you're still weighing those options. They're getting one of those champions.
Yep. Let's see which one, as Direwolves now have their final ban to decide on. Not too long left. And what will it be? It is Diana. So they do respect
Kog'Maw.
The mid lane is, that is the obvious thing. Kardred, a very well-known Kog'Maw player, and there's pretty much the insta-lock.
Yeah, not a surprise. Kardred's going to lock up what is the strongest character right now in League of Legends in patch 6.3. You can build team comps around it, and the big thing is usually Braum as your support. So Direwolves with their next rotation
should take Braum.
They should definitely go Braum Lucian. I think they should just take the Braum now.
I actually would really like them to go Braum Gragas.
Yeah.
Simply because Gragas can be really punishing against Kog'Maw. He is fairly low mobility, and again, if he's not using his W, he's technically a mid-range AD carry when he's just using his base auto attack, and obviously Gragas is able to dunk him, or we're going to call it the alley-oop, pretty easily.
Yep. Nice little combo in there. As the Lucian Hover does come out there from Sybil, Dial's maybe just thinking about completing a bottom lane and leaving some of their picks for later.
Well, we did see Sybil last game choose to go for the Lee Sin when the Gragas was available, so maybe just not feeling confident on the champion despite such fantastic performance on it yesterday.
Well, we're not going to stick to Rusty the Prophet, at least for now. There's Braum Lucian Hover. 2 seconds left for the Divers to lock it in. And there it is.
I didn't actually want them to lock in the Lucian in first rotation. I wanted that to be their bot lane, but not like this.
Not like this. Well,
yeah, I think Gragas would have been better.
Well, that's what they've got. And this could just give juice to Gragas. Joel, my.
Oh.
Janna and Gragas. Disengage everywhere.
That's the big thing. So if you remember back in 2014, Janna and Gragas were like the two champions that you could never have on the same team because the displacement and the disengage potential is massive. You can't give a team with a hyper carry like Kog'Maw in the current state that he's in 6.3, both of the primary... Like, if they get Poppy on top of this, dunzo.
That's a good way to say it.
Kind of hope Sharp takes Poppy now, actually.
Watch me like Poppy. Oh, man. I'd be...
Well, we'll give it a bit as Dials are going to consider their next few picks, but a lot to worry about now already in this draft for them.
Oh, my God.
given the start of it for Sin.
That's, I could round it out with an Orianna.
Oh, man. But that's the really scary thing. So
it's
6.3.
Two comps. It's the 80 carry and the Wombo in one.
6.3 Kog'Maw is obviously terrifying. But the thing is there should never really be a meta where Kog'Maw can exist when Zed is also very strong. That was kind of the idea. Alex Ichev even said if Zed is playable, Kog'Maw should not be. The difference between then and now is how many displacement and disengaged champions are now viable in the meta. Champions like Poppy, who with the rework weren't playable then, which just gives so much more security to Kog'Maw alongside the Rageblade.
And Zed being changed 0.5 seconds on the ultimate. You can't go in and immediately peace out and still do your damage. You actually have to sit there and maybe get an auto attack in. You get destroyed.
Yep.
Yeah, especially with all this disengage. Maybe something like Kassadin is what Fandix is thinking, but we'll decide on mid lanes later because Udu and Fiora were the picks there for Direwolves. So Sharp going to go back to a carry, interestingly enough, like a hard carry. And Sibyl going back to that Udyr. I guess with Gragas not available, he wasn't feeling the Lee Sin. And LeBlanc and Trundle are going to finish things off here.
That is very... I'm going to say it's very good, honestly. It's interesting that they've decided to go for this particular style. What they've got now is a mid laner LeBlanc who is underrated as a sieger as well. Gives a lot of potential, at least burst. And Kog'Maw feels safer because everyone looks at the LeBlanc and kind of has to deal with this person jumping around hurting your team. Trundle's always going to be competent at split pushing or at least holding his own what is going to be against the Fiora.
Likewise, like the Poppy, Trundle's going to offer a lot of disengage as well, obviously with the pillar and his ability to slow down multiple players, play around choke points.
Yeah, I like this as well in general, having the Trundle to try and answer potential split pushing from Sharp as well. So smart little adaptation there for Sin. They probably wanted Poppy but are happy to swap back now that they've seen the top lane pick. And this, of course, does leave Fantix with that final pick here. I kind of expected an Assassin to deal with the Kog'Maw, but he's actually going to pick a Control Mage by the looks of things. Victor final pick there. Oh, no. Never mind. Straight to Fizz.
There you go, Fantix. Changes it up. Back to, I'm not going to say what is a standard Fantix champion, but something that has an abundance of kill pressure, but doesn't have to all in. So if the fish doesn't connect, you don't have to go in. And that's the difference here, right? Is they've got so many disengaged tools on Sin that if you were something like a Zed, you would get knocked around like it's nobody's business. Diana instantly would die anyway, even if though that's banned. Like, Fizz is probably a happy medium between I can kill you and I don't have to kill you.
I just feel like Fizz is another one of those pocket Fantix champions that he's probably played a couple hundred games on and knows really well. He loves the, you know, the very mechanically intensive, complex champions. Fizz outplays, sort of fits under that. When we saw Zed, it was okay. Only played it once in the OPL. I think Fizz is the sort of thing they need in this comp, but getting through all of this from Sin is going to be very tricky, especially if Kadred has another good game.
The other issue is also, excuse me, Sibyl on Udyr. I know, Rusty, you talked about that Sibyl knows how to play Udyr and he can be a fantastic Udyr, but the last time we saw it, he didn't just farm his power spike out. He attempted to sit in brushes and try to gank early with Udyr.
Mm-hmm. And I think he needs to change that up a bit this time. I think he should be looking to farm, get everybody maybe looking safe and towards their first item, but honestly, just let Sharp.
Well, we'll have to see what happens here because Sin are on the verge of a 2-0 sweep and upset here. Use that hashtag Sinwin if you think they are going to get the sweep here. Oh, the hashtag DW win if you think the Dials are going to make it push it all the way to game three once again. Don't forget, of course, to use the hashtag IMOPL. Who knows? Maybe one of your tweets could be featured in the broadcast. Super Week's been a lot of fun so far, so plenty of League of Legends and time to get those tweets in.
Absolutely, and this is a very important game. Sin are on the rise as well. Fifth place and not too far away from that top four, which is the semi-finals berth. Super Week, what a way to kick it off for Sin.
Well, we did mention at the top of the day, it was a tough Super Week ahead for Sin, but right now, on the verge of toppling at least one giant here, is there a game away from taking out the Direwolves?
Hey, I know how this works. If they beat Direwolves, Direwolves beat Chiefs. That means Sin better than Chiefs.
Maybe. Quite possibly, as you're going to have a little check-in with the Keystone Masters. Nothing particularly unusual here. In fact, I'm going to say standard there for those ones. I do like the Windspeaker's Blessing on Janna, though. We don't see Janna too often.
Didn't Avant beat Sin as well? Or something like, we could go super deep and say, like, everyone is...
That's too deep. We're too deep. Eject.
Now I'm sad that Dials lost the OPL Legend to Legacy, because it could be bouncing around everywhere this week. Instead, it seems that Legacy might hold on to it. Actually, we're going to find that out later after this one, but we have a couple games to play until then.
We have seen a lot of Janna in terms of NA. I believe Adrian is the primary player for her. Mm-hmm. I wish there had been more Janna. I know that OPL plays it a little bit, especially in Denium. I always want to say Denim.
Denian, yeah.
Always. Every single time.
Denim Genian.
Best Janna OPL. Simply because of the rise of the triple AD carry composition. And with Kog'Maw getting stronger, it inherently buffs Jonna simply because they work so well together. Kog'Maw's going to prioritize building attack speed, and Jonna's 5 points in E give a free BF sword worth of stats if she puts the shield on them, so compensates for a lot of the fact that he's not just building the flat damage.
And since Duolane are waiting so long to get to this lane because they really want the lane swap, I think they saw Fiora and then wanted to double check to make sure that Raze and Kuden went top, but now they are there. They're going to be late to this lane. Kuden going to go in to check that jungle, but Sin get the swap they wanted here. They waited a long time for this.
Seems to be the blueprint, however, for beating the Direwolves is lane swapping against them.
Definitely feels like macro play is their Achilles heel, at least from what we've seen so far. But Direwolves were also very much prepared for this one, as they did have the double jungling start.
I like the fact that it's Achilles. Like, obviously Achilles heel is just a really well-known saying, but it's still like the Direwolves. They're absolutely terrifying. It's still like this Greek warrior.
Ooh, I like this from Kuden. Another level one gank. Rhymemaster.
That's rude.
Probably getting sick of it at this point, but he'll be okay. Shakes it off. Fandix going to get a little less pressure under that turret. Pops the E. Wow. See how much CS he can get under the turret. Nice trade. Crafting potion doing some work. Fandix keep going here.
I can't believe that E connected onto Rhymemaster, but it did, and then gets an auto attack. Thunderlord's proc. Damn. See you later.
Fandix level 3 now. Does have teleport as well, by the way, so no ignite this time. He's going to have the more macro-oriented summoner spell, excuse me. As Sharp level 2 roams in on the Fiora, Dio's going to try and take a turret.
And this is the biggest difference between the fact that Sin's bot lane was so late to the lane, is that their wave isn't prepped and ready to hit at the same time.
Juice is here.
Yeah, he is. Fandix forced to flash, but there's the body slam going to follow in. That's a kill. Juice gets himself first blood.
And showing off his mechanics as well, getting that flash body slam in. Forcing an early flash out of Fandix made that all too easy to secure. Direwolves, of course, still going to be trading turrets with Sin, but their jungler making it happen.
Fandix again, a little too aggressive perhaps in those trades as Sharp does collect the gold. He's going to try and keep the wave here for as long as possible. Sin going to take a little more time to take this outer turret out, but it will be gone relatively quickly.
This also highlights the major difference between a Gragas and a Nudi in regards to jungling. Sibyl was never going to gank. He was never looking at ganking, but randomly, Fantix managed to find map pressure off of a mechanical misplay from Rhymemaster. And so immediately, Juve's is like, I must gank this lane. Rhymemaster must win or we lose.
There is a freeze option available in the bot lane right now.
Certainly is, but we do have a tweet. It's actually from Spawnlore. Set 1 looks great so far. I can't wait for Set 2 tonight. Our OPL legend match between Legacy and Trident should be very fun.
Who's that guy?
I don't know.
He's a guy that looks like me, I think.
I think he is, yeah. Sure. Oh, it's your brother, yeah. No, nice guy.
I was going to say, is that Rusty?
It is right. I am very excited for the Legend match.
Should be a lot of fun. Is Juve's busy taking Rhymemaster to CS? I guess he's minding it. Rhymemaster, though, going to step back in and get it. As you do see, double non-magic mantle out for both mid laners. Fandix has gone back. That does, of course, have that death. So we'll see if Juve's can continue to apply pressure. Or maybe on the other side, just if Rhymemaster has enough space now to try and snowball this lane a little further ahead. Back in the bottom lane though, Raze and Kuden have moved themselves here into standard lanes, and Kadrid's actually topside right now, taking a bunch of farm.
Yeah, so Kadrid is one of the OG lane swappers in regards to AD carries. He's playing with the original Legacy when the 4v0 meta became a thing, and that was Legacy's prime essentially in map play. And they understand what it means to give the AD carry frozen waves. They're also prioritizing it onto a hyper carry this time, which is the Kog'Maw.
In response, though, the Direwolves are moving very aggressively into Sin's jungle, and they're actually considering a dive as the arrows go down.
You can see Sibyl is getting chased out of his own jungle, though, but here is the dive that you mentioned. Sharp looking for it. Tornado's used. That might be the go button. Never mind. Raze gets chomped. They don't really fancy it right now. Just a bit of poke there. But they know Juve's is down here already. Although Sibyl's also come in for the party.
They've just been kind of following each other down here.
And that's the thing. Jonna isn't as useful as Alistar in a dive situation like that, which is why Direwolves were considering pulling the trigger. But with Juve's also being down here, it gets a little scarier.
Wow.
Yeah, they're going for it. They want it. Kuden moves his way forward. That's actually just a threat perhaps, but they're getting some decent tower damage as a result. I like the pump fake. But Dials can't stay here forever.
I feel like they actually should have pulled the trigger as soon as the tornado didn't connect on anyone, but a lot of respect's being given to the CC being clumped up against the body slam from Juve's.
That's also three disengaged champions sitting under a turret, so if there's one thing that they could have done is live, considering the Rogue has his exhaust and flash available to him.
Sybil rocks in the mid lane, casually takes a tower hit. Rymaster doesn't seem too bothered by it though. You can see Fandix level 6 now, potentially get some fish action happening.
Rusty, maybe you can enlighten me. Sybil to me seems like such an aggressive, proactive jungler as we see him literally chasing into Juve's jungle. Mm-hmm. He wants to make things happen on his map. And you know, you said that he was a good Udyr player, which I respect that. He seems like a good everything player, just mechanically very sound. But Udyr doesn't seem to fit into his MO as a playstyle. Like, the fact that he's running by trying to gank mid lane on, like, level 4 Udyr.
It's a unique thing to Sybil, I will say. If there's anything that you could say, is we'll just let this happen first.
Kuden pops in Unbreakable. Trophy's good there from Chippies, but not enough for the kill. As Kyle does actually return to the bottom lane now. He's got a pickaxe. So he's halfway there to the Ginsu's Rage Blade.
It says a lot about Sybil as a player as well, though, that he is... Yeah, so what he's doing, and this is not so much what Sybil is doing, it's what the Direwolves need from him. And this is why Udyr in particular may not be suited to Sybil as a player for the team. Definitely still suits Sybil. He could power farm. Absolutely. Could spend the entire time getting ahead. But what he needs to do is keep tabs on Juice, who is going to gank for whatever lane that he chooses. And if that gank goes off, Direwolves could be in a lot of trouble. And it feels a bit weird to say. Direwolves tilt super hard. Like, you just don't want them to get ganked. Like, Sybil's job is damage control. And by seeing where Juve is, he's going to protect any damage from happening.
I've always felt that Udyr was kind of like old school Shyvana in the sense that I'm here to make the other jungler as worthless as I am in the early game.
Yeah, so that's what he's doing.
Well, working out so far, I guess, apart from the great gank by Juve in the early game right onto mid lane. That was tricky. But seems like standard lanes, maybe probably where the Direwolves feel strong. They actually have a gold lead, despite the first kill and the turrets being equal. That's quite impressive.
Yeah, and a lot of that is in the CS discrepancies pretty much across the map. Udyr especially, 19 to 30. That's a big difference concerning the jungle, but also between the AD carries, although a wave is pushing into Kardrit here, 61 to 82. So again, being punished for initiating that lane swaps as slowly as they did.
Mm-hmm. And again, just sitting here, biding their time. Sin, of course, are happy to take it a bit later because they've got the Kog'Maw, but he does need to get his farm going. Mid lane is just farming it out as well after the early action. As Fandix feels pretty safe right now, he's going to go take his blue buff, or just get it. Sybil's able to help him with that one. But Abyssal Scepter's on the way once again. I like the mid lane flavor we have here. You know, everyone just wants to get aggressive, so get your MR item, get your dueling item.
Yeah.
And then throw your face at it.
It's kind of funny how that works. Of course, LeBlanc not getting the blue buff. Fantix is. Could be a major difference. It's the kind of champion Fizz where if you get aggressive and use your distortion anyway, you can just throw the fish at you. If it lines up right. And even if you go back to the distortion, you'll still get hit by the fish because it's just such a long range.
Seems like Juz is looking mid. The card is going in trouble. Good block there from Kuden. I haven't seen the matchup too often, but this was part of the reason why people stopped playing Jungle.
The power shift when Kog'Maw gets the level 6 is pretty massive, especially the damage on the... I want to say Q. The damage on the R now.
I like
Rippy
it.
Rippy cam.
Yeah, Rippy cam.
I was
back.
So concerned with this. The Udyr cam.
I like it. Now we have Udyrception. I mean, to be honest, it's probably the best way to illustrate what Sybil's doing in this game. There's a lot of movement and pressure as Direwolves will actually get the bottom turret for themselves.
Yeah, they pick up the bottom turret, and it's nice. That's basically an organic 2v2 bottom turret through pressure. And what they did was hide the lane swaps in until they felt like they were strong enough to 2v2, but they'd fallen behind in farm to the point where it hasn't actually impacted the 2v2. It still hurts them, and so the turret does fall.
Well, up here in the top side though, Chippies trying to keep those creeps
dragon
up the tower as Sybil. Well, his team is actually getting the dragon.
I don't know where to look.
I know, Rusty's like literally like, and this is how you get Challenger. And I'm like, but he's on the dragon.
Well, the dragon is going to go to Direwolves, so thank you, Udyr Camp. Able to get us some additional information.
I feel like it needs a better name than Udyr Camp.
It's Rippy Camp.
Rippy Camp?
Rippy Camp. It's not even Rippy. That's Sybil, mate. All right.
Udyr is. I actually played a game the other day and I stopped calling him Rippy by accident. Yep. Started calling him Udyr, and the contrast as well. Started calling him Rippy when I was watching an Udyr.
Well,
Udyr is Rippy.
All right, we're wrong with it. Rippy Cam it is. Ripping it up there, taking out the wolves.
Yes, it is puns with it too.
Oh, now we've gone too far.
Isn't that every play-by-play caster's dream?
No, absolutely not.
Rip into it.
Please no. As Jeeves again still defending his jungle, this time actually from Fiora. A sharp looking towards Titanic Hydra.
Rippy is effectively like an OPL legend as well.
He is. It's a pretty good story. You can take that one with him forever. It'll also be with the organization forever, which is awesome. Hey guys, that one time I played Udyr in the OPL. Sybil remembers. He's been playing Udyr all the time. He's clearly learning from Rippy.
You can say that.
I think we've gone too far. let's reset here and have a look where we actually are in the game.
I want to talk about Sin, Direwolves. We talked about the Crescent vision that Sin had last game. Check the Direwolves vision around that Baron pit. They've just made, like, an arena.
Arena vision?
Arena vision.
That is suitable for the Direwolves.
It's surround sound. Look at that.
Bandit's trying to wave clear. Juice with a nice play, but a nice unbreakable from Kudin. Just going to stop that all preemptively. Fantix does eat a Mimic Sigil, taking Kokia from the Kog'Maw as well.
Yeah, trying to group up in Siege. This is one of the issues in taking a Fizz into that mid lane as opposed to the Victor, which Fantix had hovered previously, is that you are very susceptible to Siege, which forces the rest of the Direwolves to get behind him and protect this tower. Fortunately, Juves did fumble the cask against a nice Unbreakable, so a lot of pressure has been alleviated because that cooldown is down.
Sharp in topside as well, though. Starting to get pretty far forward here in the lane. Does have a nice CS lead. Closing in on 30 as Chippies returns to the lane. And you can see they're both trying to be split pushers here, but if one of them's ahead, especially significantly, that could be an easy window for the Direwolves to try and leverage the slim gold lead they currently have. And look at Sybil just hunting this top side, taking the jungle where he can, making sure to cover Sharp at every possibility.
Yeah, he's just going to make sure that Sharp can get further and further ahead. It's pretty standard stuff here from the Direwolves. They've got more lanes that they can focus opposed to potentially Sin, who primarily work around Rhymeister and ensuring that he's okay. And even that attempt to break the mid lane turret not actually coming to fruition hurt Sin, because that was a big movement around the map and setup time for them.
Well, Rageblade is now there for Kog'Maw, so first item online there for Kardrit. Essence Fever, of course, there for Razor's topside. We're looking at a gank. Sharp get ulted up by the Trundle, but Juve's not able to connect. Didn't have his ultimate there either. So unsuccessful, Sharp is going to get away from that one.
Yeah, and you're absolutely right. Obviously, the Rage Blade synergizes so well with Kog'Maw, and completing an item is always going to be a power spike. But Rusty's talked about this at length. Kog'Maw right now, because Rage Blade takes the magic damage item and the attack damage item, pickaxe and blasting wand, you lose so much power in your build path that other champions like Lucian don't have to go through that trough.
Certainly not. You can see Rift Herald not going to be a bother this time here for Direwolves. Probably give that one over to Sybil. Going to run around the lanes.
He's so fast now.
Apply that wherever he can. Certainly is. And that's just one point in bear. This Chippy's actually, this could be a problem. Going to bear up, get slapped. No, not this time. Ulti forced out by two different, by Kudin, sorry. But a flash was used there by Chippies to make sure he was okay.
Sin need to be applying pressure to the mid lane right now. And I think that they're just taking this a little bit too casually. They're going to get some decent
use
damage,
the fish.
But I'm waiting for him to go in.
You can clear the wave with it. Like, you don't have to hit Kardrit.
Yeah.
Use the fish.
Well, no fish forthcoming, and that is going to be the mid tower falling. I like the Janna Cog interaction as well. A little bit of bonus siege potential, I suppose.
Yep. Obviously, Janna's Tailwind passive allows people to move between the lanes, so you can siege out your outer sides faster. And then again, once Janna is level 9, she becomes the ultimate siege assistant because you have the 5 points in E, which, here, have a free BF sword.
Sybil and Fantix going to group up for the blue, though. Fantix now without a mid lane turret to farm at. Could be a bit unsafe, but he's kept open CS. Rhymeister has 2, though. We'll see which assassin can have a bigger impact. If Sharp's trying to steal it, he does. Gets the guaranteed crit there on the big one and takes it out from under Juves. Got the Titanic Hydra already finished. It does feel like Sharp might be the bridge here for Direwolves towards the middle of this game. He's causing so much pressure on this bottom side. He's basically this push threat they wanted last game when Rhymeister was on Diana.
Yeah, essentially. Of course, Chippy's changing it up, going Trundle's never going to die. I mean, that's the major bonus for Sin. They're not looking to split push themselves this time. They're looking to siege. And so it's two defined strategies from Sin. The problem is, it's something we've always seen from them. No matter what team composition they've got in place, they default to team fighting and wombo combos. You can run a siege composition, they're probably going to have to flash Janna somehow to like double it up with a keg for it to work for them because they just love Wombo.
Sharp. He's trying to defend that pink ward, and it looks like he will be successful. Still down here in the bottom side as Fantix has now transferred power into that top half of the map. His TP's up as well. Didn't quite talk about it before, but there is potential for maybe Fantix to be a secondary split pusher here for the Direwolves also.
Yeah, and entirely possible, honestly. I think he will be. He does have to pick the lane, though, that doesn't have the Trundle. So it's defined when they actually want to do it.
Group in mid now, though. Cardred going to defend it off. That was easy. Got the Zeal now as well for a bit of extra attack speed. Always a bit of extra goo onto the back of Raze.
I feel like there's pressure on Direwolves right now to be proactive around the map since they do have momentum and control. Right now, Sin has set up that they've just effectively created three different farm lanes. And they're totally fine doing this. Again, they have the hyper scale with that Kog'Maw, but Direwolves, I feel like they're going to get antsy. We do see that they're flanking onto the side there, but spotted out by a pink ward.
Still impressed by the farm, honestly, for Direwolves, because pretty much all their gold lead is just based on the individual farm. Turrets are equal. They do have a dragon, but it doesn't give any gold. They're going to get a second one here, which might make some of their siege efforts in mid lane a little easier.
Yeah.
But up 2,500 gold, down a kill. There's only been one. Sin do have it. But they've been farming very efficiently.
Yeah, it's definitely a decent lead for Direwolves in regards to their farm. Of course, it will help them a fair bit once the next item is done for Raze. The concern is that by that time, Kog'Maw will have two items also, and the Hurricane will be there. And that's when he really starts to hurt.
Well, Sharp in trouble here as well. Gonna have to rip us off the snare, does, but Rhymaster just ignites him. Flash forward in. Sharp really can't juke all of this, and he's just gonna die.
There should have been at least an ultimate from Sharp to try and turn it around, maybe get some health back from Vitals, or even just the move speed from the ultimate wasn't placed there, and Sharp, not respecting, goes down.
And again, this is an issue because it isolates Sin with these three free farm lanes, and this is exactly where they want to be. Power spike pressure still on Direwolves to make a play. And I think it has to be the mid lane almost, but trying to gank or pressure into a Janna, super hard.
They also had wrong lane allocation. Now they actually have Fantix going down to deal with Rhymaster. It's where it should have been the whole time.
Yeah, you see it cost them there. Sybil takes the blue buff again. Again, strong overall pressure here. Sybil might look a little silly, but running around on Udyr, causing pressure. And just, again, like you mentioned, keeping tabs on everyone, Rusty, has been working out for the Direwolves so far. Sin feel very constricted with the way they're playing back into their half of the rift right now.
Yeah.
And the Direwolves are able to take advantage of that, but it does feel like there's a ticking time bomb here almost. We're about to hit 20 minutes into this game. The Direwolves are still farming up, and Sin, more than happy to keep farming.
You can see Rhymaster just then danced in the middle lane, deciding which lane he wanted to go to, and immediately goes towards Sharp's lane. Does not want to deal with Fantix on this Fizz, and they actually swap their lanes to make sure they're getting the ideal matchups. And this is favoring Sin once again, because Frostgrins kept alluding to this fact. They're just farming. They're allocating their farm nicely. And eventually, it will hit a point where Kardred is stronger than everybody.
And likewise, the Direwolves are losing their gold surpluses on their CS because they're spending so much time moving between the lanes, trying to avoid the LeBlanc, trying to avoid the Trundle. And we're starting to see these CS gaps closing.
Well, good news for the Direwolves because that's pretty much what their lead's been built on in this particular game. Rhymaster again. Gonna get aggressive, and that's a huge amount of damage. Sharp, gonna get chained up. He does get the stun, actually. Very nice riposte.
That was very important.
Saved
if he didn't hit that, yeah, he would have died 100%. Rhymaster has a lot of burst. Two big items completed. And being able to sit in that bush comes back to the preparation that Sin have played. They're communicating the fact that LeBlanc wants to be the one fighting Fiora. For better or worse, naturally.
I think a massive issue for Direwolves' composition, at least right now, because they are or they need to be proactive, is that they simply don't have the tools on their comp to be proactive. Sybil's been kind of the guy that takes charge and leads when they do get their massive gaming victories, but on the Odir, he's shelved to farm. It's pretty much on Kuden and Fantix to step up and say, we're fighting now, we need to take advantage while this Kog'Maw is still weak, but now has two items.
This could be the fight. I think Kardra might be the target here. Sharp is going to line something up. Fantix also moving in for it. They're going to look for some vitals. They find Juves. They pop the ulti, but Kardra just turns it around. He's got the runins. That is massive damage from the Kog.
That's a lot of damage, and that is the two-item Kog'Maw that we were worried about happening if you were a Direwolves player.
But they do get better posture on this mid-tier tower.
to an extent.
No, juice! Huge play and just deletes poor Lucian off the rift as now Kuden gonna get chased down, executed by the Kadred ulti. Huge misplay from Dials and well capitalized by Juves.
That's why Rusty was saying to an extent, didn't expect them to walk up and just slap the tower and you give Gragas a free.
You can absolutely tell how confident Sin are right now. They recognize that with two items on their Kog'Maw, they can team fight. LeBlanc's also doing well. Direwolf's not respecting.
And it sounds really strange to say that Sin, again, had a really beautiful macro game, and at least as far as game two has been. But absolutely honest, even though they weren't proactive as they were in game one, this idea that understanding how to freeze the lanes to open up three farm waves, and as Rusty said, to allocate the correct side lanes and get the matchups that they want. Beautifully orchestrated by Sin.
Still behind on gold. Why not matter here though? Sharp and Rhymaster are going to go at it again, but Sharp this time happy to fight. Riposte a little late. Chippies actually might be able to take him out, but Sybil's here. The Trundle Pillar's good. Flash auto straight to the face, and now Sybil has to run away, but he's getting chomped. The chain is not quite there. And Sybil's able to skirt away this time.
This magic 8-ball is a god. It's an absolute legend.
It may be. His dragon is up in a minute 5. Dials do have 2 already. They can look to that potentially as a way to keep themselves up in this game. But it's awfully close, 23 minutes in, and Sin already have the first game in the bag. Again, Kog'Maw will only get stronger from this point. Trundle will only get stronger from this point, and I feel like the Assassins are going to neutralize each other. The Dials are sort of running out of time to make this game work for themselves.
Udyr will get massive as well. I don't know if you've played against one yet, Julian, but
I have.
A 6-item Udyr.
It is awful.
Is fairly frustrating, and we did see the Direwolves have great success on that earlier, but they're facing against possibly the best composition to stop Udyr because he's actually very kiteable. And against a Janna, Gragas, and Trundle, it's going to be very hard to get to that back line unless he finds a perfect flank or center lazy on their vision.
This is so easy to just bring back to mistakes in drafting, though. Direwolves going for the Udyr, giving them the Gragas. Yep. So they have a Gragas, Janna, Kog'Maw composition just set from like their first three champions. Like, you just have to question it. I mean, yeah, 6-item Udyr is great, but the problem is they're at 2. And they need to get to 6, which means like this 3-item spike that Sin have, I feel like they need to spend 10 minutes past that, not dying and farming and actually turtling Direwolves if they need to get to that stage. Thankfully, they'll have Rot Portals in their back pocket.
Yep, that's the Rot Portal coming out for Sybil. Direwolves are going to attempt this dragon. Sin are more than happy to fight, they're ready.
Chippy's flying.
Direwolves getting it low. Sin needs to pull the trigger relatively soon. Chippy's going to get dove on. They are going to ult him up there with Fiora. Rhymaster in the middle of the maw gets exhausted as Rogue in the backside getting munched down by Fandix, doing a huge amount of damage as Raze has gotten the first kill out into Chippy's. Kadric will slay Fandix on the back end though, and the Kog'Maw is still alive and healthy.
These are excellent areas to fight the Kog'Maw comp.
Juice! Post use. Dragon does go to Dials. Rhymaster, be careful. Does get himself out.
So what I was going to say, I was like prepping forward as they were setting up for this dragon, is this was possibly the best case scenario for Direwolves coming to this fight. Yes, Kog'Maw is on his item power spike, so he wants to do it, but you saw Fantix get into the back lane right there and do so much damage, and you force a lot of flashes for Sin to reposition themselves, get their tank line in front of them. Fighting in jungles, fighting in the Baron and the Dragon Pit are absolutely where Direwolves need to be because it helps them get those flanks. Sin want to fight in the long lanes because they want to have everyone in front of this Kog'Maw.
Yeah, the only mistake was the assumption of spells about to kill Fantix, so he uses the Zonias and gets completely caught out. That entire fight was who can kill the front line first, and what it came down to was Chippies, not tanky enough just yet, did go down very quickly, and when Rhymeister threw his face into the front line to hurt Raze, he paid for it as well.
Yeah, I feel like that was Direwolf's best chance to kind of get their foot back into this game, and so now they have to be very conservative with how many more mistakes are allowed to them.
Well, they do get something out of it, at least. It is the dragon and a third one at that, so starting to ramp up the objectives now, but I think I agree. Not quite enough, given what they could have gotten there in that particular engagement. The Direwolves will reset and look to try something else. The Rot Portal finish, though, for Sybil.
Here we go.
Starting to have some fun.
It is going to be very important that Kardrid's flashes down for the next 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. So I suspect that Sin will be very patient and passive. So that opens up a lot of room for Direwolves to kind of spread out their vision along this river and try to bait Sin into the jungle.
There is a flip side, though, is that Gragas does have his flash available. So there is a very real chance if they make a pick, Kadra doesn't need the flash. He can just stand still and spit.
And that's the big thing. Pick versus a 5v5.
Well, we'll have to see which comes out ahead, because this game is awfully close still. I honestly feel like Dials think they're behind, given the way they're playing right now. And we can see the goal. It makes our job very easy. Dials are up by only 1,000. And it's not a very big lead, but they're up. It just feels like Sin are playing like they're still ahead, waiting for their comps to come online. And then again, we'll hit 35, 40 minutes, and Sin are just going to move everyone forward and win.
To be fair, though, Kog'Maw with the two-item power spike is putting out so much damage.
Oh, Sharp Nose. This is good, though. Onto Chippies. The damage could be enough. Never mind. Trundle, unkillable? Maybe not. Vital's there. Needs the last one. That's not it. And now the pillar's going to come in. Bandit's going to try and move as well. And also Rhymeister here. That's going to force the cancel. And Sharp, being a duelist that can't duel anyone, it's a bad time.
That was just outright foolish from Sharp. And that was good from Chippies, though, standing next to the wall, not giving him the passive to heal him back up. But wow, that's an aggressive decision from Sharp that backfires and hurts Direwolves now.
Certainly is, and you can see there from James Leong at Tobias, praise Magic 8-Ball, hashtag IMOPL. Magic 8-Ball is looking good tonight.
That 8-Ball, I don't know if any teams need an analyst, but that guy's free.
He's free. He's available.
You stay away.
I don't know if he's available. A Sin is going to munch down this turret.
I almost feel like in draft phase, like Direwolves, they effectively, okay, should we pick Udyr here? Shook the Magic 8-Ball. Do it.
Well, they did it.
All signs point to yes. Lock it in.
Sybil is going to get a tower. Speaking of Mr. Rippy, there in the top
That's
side.
That's actually good. He can Rot Portal and Split Push as an Udyr. Why not, you know? Like, he's got the 800 gold lead, which was the major difference between these teams.
And he's so fast.
Yeah, you can't kill him. When he's near a dead turret, like, good luck.
Kill him. You can't catch him.
Well, you can see those Rot minions doing some work. Chippy's actually mid lane. Braze, I would
you
stand
are in
there.
Trouble.
Not a good time. Does dash out, but Chippy's still chasing. QSS is going to use everything. The fish even burnt just to keep him alive. Raze again playing up so far forward there.
That was definitely playing up. I think the best way to describe it. He was not having a bar of any defensive attitude. He wanted to go all in on that turret and pays for it. Chippy's is doing a lot of damage.
And this is starting to fall apart a bit for the Dials. We mentioned again, they're still ahead technically in this game. The Baron damage is disgusting.
Oh, it's genius. They Rot Portaled the bush.
They Rot Portaled the bush so they could see and get vision when this flank was coming in, but here comes the TP.
Well, Sybil looking for it. Sharp found Rogue. That's not the worst target for a free pick, but Sharp gonna have to riposte back in. Kudin trying to lock down Chippies as the rest of Sin are chasing somebody else. There's Chippies gonna get locked down. Raze eats the Casco from Juves. And the Dials just don't quite have enough. Sybil, though, in the middle of the fight, might be able to get something done. Rogue will finally die, but they need to get onto Kadra. Juves is low, but if they can get some picks as the fight does flow out, that might be all right. Juves is going to die to Fantix. And Rhymeister sort of caught out the side here. Sybil going to keep chasing. Rhymeister's in trouble. Distort's back. They're going to wait. He actually will get away, I think.
Yeah, they want to do the Baron. So immediately, Direwolves win a team fight with two members dead of Sin. That was their disengage, using it on themselves. We're now looking at a hero Rhymeister Kadra play, and Chippies is making his way in, but he won't be
they
here.
They do so much damage. Kadra needs to be in position to try and shoot them. Oh my god! He stole the Baron!
You've got to be kidding me!
That's disaster for the Direwolves.
I would kill him. They're going to try and chase him down. The Dire is going to try and get a, I'm going to call it a lash out kill.
Meanwhile.
Turn around and spit on them. Just do it. Kadra, it's all good.
He's got cooldowns.
Just do damage.
He's been spotted.
He's going to try.
He can't execute now.
He can kill Fantix.
Get in there.
He should kill Fantix.
Him.
He's got no mana.
He's W. Costs nothing.
No, I'm talking about Fantix.
Oh. I know. That's what I mean. I have no idea. Either way, look. He stole the Baron. MVP cartridge.
Doesn't give an assist away. But how did this even happen?
LeBlanc burst damage came through and he gets it with the E.
Oh my god.
Of all things. Like, of all things, Akudin was blocking the LeBlanc, so he had a flank with the spit. They're ridiculous.
Okay. There were a couple of really cool things, so let's, like, quickly break this down. First and foremost, the placement of the Zerat portal. It's actually cleared now, but it's in that little brush that enters into the red jungle. And the reason why they put it there is because not only does it apply pressure and force a mid or a wave into the mid lane, it gives you information and vision, and that's what you're getting the information off of, is the vision that the little minions are doing, because every time they spawn, they take information with them, so you can see the enemy coming. What's beautiful about Direwolves comp is if they're in a scenario, again, when they're on a dragon, when they're on a baron, that's exactly where they want to fight. It had this awesome fighting two different flank where someone was behind them, someone was in front of them, and they need to continue to force that.
That was dragon number four.
Yep.
To keep that in mind, even though the Baron was stolen, this is definitely an opportunity for Sin to make something happen.
And Sybil is starting to go off on this Udyr. You guys were joking before, or not joking, but you were mentioning before that six-item Udyr is a very real thing. He's starting to get quite strong here.
Six-item Udyr is legend tier, but the issue is that he's still against a composition where he has to get back to that Kog'Maw. They have to fight in the jungle, and Sin have to stay in the lanes. As long as they can keep Gragas, Janna, and Trundle in front of him, no one will touch this Kog'Maw.
There's no teleport available right now for Sharp, but he's opting to split push instead of grouping with his team. Dangerous against the Baron'd up Sin.
Very. In fact, this tower is not going to last particularly long. Does go down.
They can trade one.
Sharp didn't get it. Okay, so not a bad trade there from Direwolf. They will get the bottom side turret. Fandix running around. Does have his TP. So maybe can look to make a play. But the Direwolves, I think, at this point have one pretty obvious game plan. Just run Sin around the map and never let the Kog'Maw group.
And that is a very defined strategy against Kog'Maws. And I like what Direwolves have done here. It was a first pick Kog. This is how you beat it. You don't meet it. Like, you just avoid it at all costs. Rot portals are the best way to combat this as well. And I like that Sybil got it instead of Sharp, who is an offensive top laner.
We'll see. He's looking for something. Again, Sin needs to keep being aggressive. Deadman's plate buffer wear off though as he eats a Braum Q to the face. And Sharp's still back on that bottom side. Teleport back up, I think.
Just about to be, yeah.
Just about. And again, Sin, the Baron's worn off. They need to keep pushing the advantage here.
We're getting there, Pastry. Well, we're not getting over there, but we are getting towards that fifth dragon.
33 and a half minutes in. About 4 or 5 minutes away from it, I think. Sybil may be caught. Can you catch Nudia? Looks like you can. Fish lands. That's onto Chippies, though. Good block. As Rhymeister is going to get poked down. Kuden puts up the shield. But Sin has so much pressure here.
Yeah, Sin are in complete control, but yeah, you'll never catch him at least. This is still a lot of health bar missing from Sybil. He still needs to recall. And they've got time now where they're missing all of their members.
They just have a window of opportunity until that dragon comes back up,
though. Turret's gone.
Yeah, I mean, no wave quick kind of makes this awkward. Fandis going to try and make a play. He gets exhausted. Pops the Zonyas as Kadrid firing away. Raze needs to try and kill him. He's going to move in for it, but the damage is just a little too much. The QSS is popped. Sybil got so low, but he did not die.
But Sin can keep going here, absolutely.
Sharp is trying to poke his way in. He made his way back. He burnt the teleport. That was the one thing they really had going for them, and that inhibitor is just dead.
Okay, so this is how Sin need to play this. As a chase might be ensuing, Sybil is fast.
Oh my god, he's so fast. The dead turret's powering him up.
Okay, so now they have control of the mid lane, and they have the supers coming through, as well as another rot portal that they can put down. Dire Wolves want to make them fight that dragon. That's their win condition right now, because if they can get that Kog'Maw, if they can find the flank, it's beautiful. Kardru doesn't have his flash up. That's massive, because it won't be up in time for the dragon fight if they fight on the timer. But Sin need to play around the pressure points that they have in the mid lane. Force that wave in, clear Dire Wolves to take care of that from the dragon pit, and stop that fifth dragon from happening. That's what needs to happen.
Well, not there yet. Baron actually up in 2 minutes, so starting to have some big objectives come up at key points in this game. Dials, again, continuing to just try and run Sin across this map. It feels like Sin just had the answers. They're still behind in gold, by the way. I find that amazing.
Well, they're about to be potentially ahead in gold.
Ooh, Chippies. Gonna find Sharp. Sharp's like, absolutely not. And I feel like Fiora can't actually split push against anyone right now.
She doesn't want to split push against someone, though. Sin's team composition is designed to have five members there. And every time that there is five members there, Sharp is split pushing. He doesn't have his teleport as well at the moment, so becomes a little bit more delicate, but you can tell he's going towards a Bloodthirster build. He definitely wants to continue splitting where applicable and not dying to the person that comes to fight him, whether it's Rhymeister or Chippies.
Sybil gonna take down his Krugs. He's been farming up a storm all game long. Ray is relatively strong as well. Actually has the Infinity Edge now completed after the Essence Reaver and the Phantom Dance that he went, which seems to be an item he quite likes.
Still no laugh for this one.
Which could be a problem against even the Jund, actually. He's got a frozen heart.
Still no Last Whisper is the biggest issue ever right now. Like, he needs a Vamp Scepter, needs the Lifesteal, needs the QSS so that he can't get engaged on, right? But he's missing his damage because of that.
Unfortunately, that means you have to finish Mercurial and then go Last Whisper. You're a while away as that blue buff gets demolished by Kardred, who's got a QSS and a Blade of the Ruined King now, just doing silly things on the damage front, especially with a bit of extra help from Rogue. And the dragon's up in 30 seconds. Baron's about to come up in about 12. They are going to steal this blue buff for Direwolves.
They've established vision quite well here, Direwolves, though, in preparation for the Baron starting. The question always comes up. They've got like 20 seconds right now between Baron spawn and Dragon spawn that they could just start it on the very beginning of it, or they could just bide their time.
I thought we were in LPL for a second.
I guess. I was going to say, that was complete conviction with the starting of it. There is a ward on top of them.
There are multiple wards, and they are going to start it. This is risky from Direwolves.
Keeps them away from the dragon as well, though.
They're going to commit to it. I think they have to finish it now. Steal again. No, they do get it. Direwolves able to do it fast enough, and Kardred gets knocked up, and Sharp tries to flash to get him. But that's not the way you want to do it. Kuden's going to die. Ray's forced to flash out. Pumps the culling as Bandix is just trying to keep it alive. Rogue is the target, but he's just going to disengage with a Monsoon. And Sharp, he's going to get chased down. That's going to be a kill onto Sybil as well. And Ray's will be lucky to live here. Maybe he's trying to kite back as much as he can. And the Dial's lost too much there.
I think they just lost the game.
Oh, Raze is dead. Nice catch from Rhymeister.
They absolutely just lost themselves the game. The desperation to start the Baron up and not choosing their fifth dragon as the easier option to take comes back to bite them. And Sin, wow.
A 2-0 magic 8-ball comes up massive as Fantic. He'll try and do what he can to defend, but he gets blown up as Sin finally finds some pep in their step. 2-0 versus the Direwolves.
In two games, Sin played a beautiful macro strategy. But what's better than that is the fact that Fish has a lower percentage than a magic 8-ball.
What is magic?
It is.
Let's give it some credit, jeez. Sin, on the other hand, they're not magic. They executed perfectly.
No, that was awesome. And they have such an uphill battle. They also have to face the Chiefs, and they just took down Direwolves.
I mean, part one done, I guess, but I just can't stop being impressed by Sin. It feels like so much has changed. It's been a week since we've seen them.
Yeah, and this is the Sin that you never really see. It's funny because they always talk the talk. They're a very vocal team, but come OPL time, they never really perform. Well, they have this time.
They certainly have put it the money where their mouth is this time, but we are going to break down that game more on Sin's 2-0 over the Direwolves. Let's pop back over to the analyst desk.
Thank you so much, Pastry Time, and the Magic 8-Ball got it right, but I do want to point out to everyone that during the article, the article that was released during the week with the tipping contest, the Direwolves actually picked Direwolves.
The Direwolves picked Direwolves?
The 8-Ball picked Direwolves.
Ah. Okay.
So not only is Atlas someone that reneged on camera, the 8-Ball also reneged on camera. I'm not going to strip it of the point for this analyst death segment, but you still lose during the article that is where the points are. So Fish, you are safe from ridicule on the article, you still suck on the desk.
I'm still, yeah, however,
whereas I just picked whatever the 8-Ball said because I couldn't actually handle the depression. That
the
I
depression that you get. All right, yeah, no, cool. All right, let's jump into this game, Howard, because I feel like it actually was a really high-level game one more time. Want to kick it off in the draft. Another Udyr game. I've been throwing questions about Sybil's champion pool all night. Can we say he has a champion pool issue yet, Atlas?
Well, the thing is, right, I'm confused because the Gragas was there. He could have picked it. Like Sybil showed a fantastic Gragas performance. He went like 3-0-11 or something like that yesterday against the Chiefs. They just leave it open. They give over the Janna Gragas combo with the Kog'Maw to Sin. It's like Sin said, "No, can you just leave those for us? Like, we've got a sweet deal for you." and we can have them because their draft was stunning for a team fight.
Yeah, it certainly was. Very, very nice draft pick up there. And the thing that I liked about Sin's draft is that it answered a 1-3-1 split push in a really unique way. They had very good split pushes in their own right, but also that their top laner was a peel-oriented top laner, and it meant very, very fun team fights. We've actually got one to pull up onto your screen. Now Fish is going to take us through it. This is actually... Okay, cool. So we're going to get the actual teamfight aspect. But before this, there'd been a long chase through the river that Sin successfully disengaged from. And then this happens, Fish.
That's right. They had Janna and Gragas. And that was able to allow them to disengage nicely. But this happened, basically. That was just Rhymeister going off, sees Raze out of position, capitalizes on it, and they get two kills for it. And this is the story of Rhymeister, really.
And everyone was speechless. Like, when that happened, like, Frostgurren's like, oh, yeah, they're in a good position. And it was like, all right, cool. Well, now they're dead. And that is Sin playing on the same page. And we haven't seen it for a while. This is why they say they keep Juves on the roster, because of his shot calling ability. Finally coming up trumps.
Yeah, and Juves has been brilliant. This series has been definitely Juves coming out of his shell. And if he can keep playing like this, my God. Sin, I mean, you asked the question earlier on, Fish, about can they get to that top four spot? They might get there by the end of the week. They've got Chiefs coming up afterwards. And look, on paper, theoretically, Sin should be the favorite.
That's right. And Sin, they came into the OPL saying that they are... everyone came into the OPL saying that Sin will be the number four team. They're top four, definitely. And everyone thought they'd sit just below the Chiefs, Direwolves, and Legacy. Now they've beaten one of those top three teams. They could definitely climb up the ranks.
So that is super exciting. And that's a matchup I want to look ahead to. So now that that's out of the way, Sin versus the Chiefs is tomorrow night. And this now becomes a massive matchup. You already mentioned that now when you look at it, theoretically, Sin is a stronger team. Chiefs have lost to Direwolves twice, 2-1 both times. Sin has just 2-0 swept the Direwolves in pretty convincing fashion, you have to say, both games. What does this series look like to you, Atlas? Like, what are you looking ahead towards?
The thing that I'm really excited about is sort of the game on a strategic level here, because when we saw the Chiefs fall to Direwolves, the sort of chaos versus control really butting heads and chaos reigning supreme, we saw it again here today, and Sin were able to make it work for them, but are they going to be able to play this control style against the masters of control that just seem to have the Achilles heel of the Direwolves at the moment? That's the real question for me.
Well, if Sin Gaming have been keeping Juves on the roster because of his shot calling ability, I think their match against the Chiefs is really going to be Juves and Rhymeister going up against Spooks and Cheese. That's what I really want to watch out for, and I think that's going to decide that game.
Yeah, and I'm really excited because Rhymeister was the mid laner that could, but Sin take the set 2-0 against Direwolves. Don't go anywhere, guys, because we have a legend match coming up after the break. It's going to be Legacy versus Trident.